This last year was the first time in 5 years that I've worked from the Mac at all. And I split my time about 50-50 between the iPad and the Mac. So I figured this would be a really good time to kind of reflect on how the Mac worked for me and how it might work for other people that have been working from the iPad for a long period of time. This video is sponsored by AnchorWork and the PowerConf C200. So I've told the story a bunch about why I had to kind of break my 5-year streak of working from the iPad and buy a MacBook. To make a long story short, the straw that broke the camel's back essentially was the app that I was using to edit videos got super buggy to the point that I wasn't able to actually export videos, which is kind of a problem considering my main source of income is making videos. So I bought a M1 Max MacBook Pro with 64 gigs of RAM and 4 terabytes of storage. I basically wanted a machine that could handle any creative task I threw at it, no matter what it was, whether if I wanted to get into 3D modeling or just editing a YouTube video. It might seem a bit like overkill, but I wanted a machine that I could hold on to for years and not having to worry about upgrading it because, you know, I cheaped out on RAM or storage or something like that. Working from the Mac again has been strange. Like I mentioned, I worked from the iPad. The iPad was my main computer, the place when I sat down to do work, that was the computer I went to for 5 years. So coming back to the Mac, because I was a big Mac user before that, was a bit strange, but also it was enjoyable. It was kind of like riding a bike. You just don't really forget how certain things work. When ordering the MacBook, kind of thought about what I was going to use it for because I didn't want to give up on the iPad completely. In fact, the iPad is still my favorite place to work, but it's not able to do everything I need it to do. So I came up with this idea of silos. So I'd have two different silos, the Mac silo and the iPad silo. And on the Mac silo, it was going to be for creative tasks. So for editing videos, editing photos, big project stuff, stuff that would benefit from a big beefy CPU, GPU, extra RAM, extra storage, stuff like that. And then the iPad was for writing, boring administrative work, emails, dealing with documents, signing stuff. The stuff that the iPad honestly really excels at, and stuff that I need to get done, the iPad is a good place to do those tasks. And throughout this whole year, that silo metaphor held. It was a good balance between the two machines. I was able to have a foot in both camps. Not only was I able to keep up with my knowledge of the iPad, but I was able to, learn more with iPadOS 16 and stuff like that. But I was also able to learn a lot about the Mac this last year as well. The Mac is a lot more open than the iPad. The Mac itself gives developers flexibility to do things that will probably never be possible on the iPad, and I see that as a big bummer. I just made a What's on My Mac video highlighting a bunch of third-party Mac apps that can basically do utilities and do things the iPad won't ever be able to do. And there's a lot of really good apps in there that I use every single day. It should already be out. If not, it will be out in the next few days. Recording all these things back to back, timelines, eh. But one of my favorite apps that I highlighted in that video is Raycast. It's a Spotlight replacement app. And it does everything Spotlight does, but it goes way beyond it. And this is where, third parties can really shine on the Mac because they can replace these first-party system features. So with Raycast, I can, open up apps and files just like I would with Spotlight, but there's also extension support. So other developers, other third-party developers can write stuff for Raycast, and me, the user, can install that so I can, create a new task from things, run a shortcut, do all sorts of different time tracking stuff. There's so many different things that you can do with Raycast. But then also the other side of that coin, for the Mac is pro apps like Final Cut and full-fledged Photoshop are on the Mac. I still can't believe that Photoshop on the iPad doesn't have the pen tool. What? But we are starting to see real true pro apps come to the iPad with stuff like DaVinci Resolve. It's here. I've been playing around with it. I know you all have been asking for a video on it. I am learning it still. It is very different from every other nonlinear editor that I've ever used, so it's taking me a bit more time than usual. About a year ago, I made a video about all the different pro apps on the iPad. And I stand by that video because there are a lot of really good apps in there. But the thing that has obviously been missing are big pro creative apps like the Adobe Creative Suite. Final Cut is a big one for a lot of video editors I know. There are a lot of big things happening. And honestly, after I made that video, I figured, okay, a year from now, we're gonna have a lot more of those. And to see only a couple have popped up in that year is a little disappointing. This video is sponsored by AnchorWork and the PowerConf C200 webcam. The PowerConf C200 is a high quality webcam. It has a 2K sensor, so you're getting a higher resolution image. That's double the resolution of the MacBook Pro's webcam, and it has a built-in microphone as well. Here's the MacBook Pro's webcam, and here is the Anchor PowerConf C200. A big benefit of this Anchor webcam over something like a standard laptop webcam is it has an adjustable field of view. So it can go all the way from a 95 degree field of view, which is fairly wide, to 78, and then all the way down to 65 if you want a really zoomed in cropped image. What I like about this is it's incredibly small. So if you need to travel with a high quality webcam because you're doing presentations or calls or whatever, you can easily throw this in your bag and it doesn't take up a ton of space. It also has a physical shutter for privacy, and when you close it, it cuts off the video data stream from the webcam to your computer. And if you're like me and care about having the best possible image, there's software you can install so you can control things like brightness, contrast, saturation, and even white balance. And if you don't necessarily care about fiddling with all those settings, there's an auto mode on by default, so it just works right out of the box. This is a great choice for anyone that is looking to upgrade their Mac's webcam. I'll put a link in the description below to where you can go check it out. My thanks to AnchorWork for sponsoring this video. A big feature this year for the iPad was an overhaul for its windowing and multitasking system with Stage Manager. And I've talked about Stage Manager to death. There are some things I like about it. There are a lot of things I don't like about it. And windowing and multitasking on the Mac is honestly a solved issue. Yeah, the Mac has Stage Manager now too, but it's an option. I don't have to use Stage Manager if I want to have some kind of resizable windows or be able to place windows wherever or some, you know, more advanced multitasking features. And then you could take it a step further on the Mac and install third-party utilities to really enhance your multitasking options. This is something that I don't ever see coming to the iPad, where you have something like Better Snap Tool. I can use this to bring the kind of Windows tiling multitasking to the Mac, and I really like that. I love being able to like snap a window to the side and be able to, you know, take up 50%, or snap it to the top and take up the whole screen. The other thing I will say about the Mac when it comes to multitasking is it has a lot of options, and another one of those options is Spaces, and I really like Spaces. This helps me, you know, stay focused on specific tasks that I'm working on, whether it's writing or editing or answering emails or whatever. Like if I'm just fully working from the Mac that day, like if I'm trying to push myself to do that, Spaces are incredibly handy. The Mac by no means is perfect. This is not a video of me saying, oh, I'm done with the iPad, I'm not coming back to it, and then like 6 months later I make a video, I'm back on the iPad. No, it's nothing like that, I promise. Like the Mac has some big positives, but for me, one of the things that is a big negative about it is what originally attracted me to the iPad. The Mac has a lot going on, especially in the background. There are apps can be doing things, apps can just pop up, information could be just jumping at you. You have the menu bar, you have the dock. There's all sorts of things happening on the Mac. And as somebody with ADHD, I find that incredibly distracting. When I do work from the Mac, especially in laptop mode, I often use the full screen features, especially if I am writing or something that day. I just like to have like a distraction-free workspace, and that's something the iPad has always been really good at. And that's why when I need to sit down and bust out emails, write, deal with boring administrative stuff, whatever, like those kinds of tasks, I always gravitate towards the iPad. The iPad is also especially good for, you know, sitting on the couch or laying in bed and like playing around with different apps or building shortcuts or just doing work or whatever. It's really good at that for one specific reason. It has no fans. And yeah, I know the MacBook Air doesn't have fans anymore and stuff like that, but I don't have one. I'm just focusing on the MacBook Pro and the other Macs and stuff. And the iPad is also an incredibly portable machine because it's, you know, a tablet. You can take it out of the Magic Keyboard. I can use it in bed as a tablet or a laptop, or I can sit on the couch with a blanket and use it with a tablet or as a laptop, whichever one I want to use it as. And that is that kind of flexibility I really like out of a computer. And that's something I don't see the Mac ever getting. It's been a year since I got the MacBook Pro, but it's not my first M series Macs. Longtime viewers might remember, I did buy an M1 Mac Mini in 2020, right after they launched. I got this as a background automation machine and a machine I could use to upload YouTube videos in the background. So I didn't have to like just leave my iPad open and I couldn't do anything with it while I was uploading videos. I just wanted a separate computer I could just upload videos for so I could still keep using my iPad at the time. But the MacBook Pro is my first Mac that I really have worked from. You know, I set up that Mac Mini, it was doing a lot of background stuff, and other than like uploading videos, I didn't really touch it very much. And I've actually since sold that Mac Mini as well. I really love this MacBook Pro. I could go over all the tech specs and really get into the details, but there are hundreds of videos, reviews, and hundreds of articles out there that talk about this machine. In fact, I've made a review about this video, so I'm not gonna review a year old computer. But what I will say is this machine is a Swiss Army knife. It's incredibly compact and portable. It's extremely powerful. Jason Snell over at Six Colors, when he reviewed it, he called it a Mac Pro in your backpack. And I couldn't agree more. Like, it's truly a powerful machine that fits in your backpack. So good. Any task I need to throw at it, it can handle. It's not an issue. The screen is beautiful. The mini LED display, it can handle HDR video editing or high-res photo editing. It's so nice for those kinds of things. And the battery life is amazing. I can do a full video edit right off the battery of this MacBook Pro and never have to plug it in. That was unheard of on previous MacBook Pros for me. Previous MacBook Pros, like if you weren't plugged in, like your battery was gonna die quickly. This one, it just goes forever. So right now I'm really happy having a foot in the iPad camp and the MacBook camp. My plan is to start covering the Mac even more on this channel. I've covered it a bit this last year, but it was really a test to kind of see if there was even interest in like my Mac takes, like, you know, what I have to say about the Mac, you know, Mac tips and tricks and stuff like that. And it's something I'm really excited about, to kind of explore the Mac again and make bigger and badder tips and tricks videos and app walkthrough videos and stuff like that. Another thing is, while I was sitting at WWDC this year, something struck me. It's not about the individual devices anymore. Apple very clearly sees it as an ecosystem and that you use the device for the context that you are in. So if I'm out and about, you know, shopping or something and I just have my iPhone, well, that's the context in which the iPhone is the device for me. If I'm sitting at my desk and I'm editing a video, the context is the MacBook Pro. If I'm, you know, sitting in the chair back there writing, the context would be the iPad. So it's not about the individual devices or, hey, I'm full-time working from the iPad. It's about the ecosystem and things like how mail updates were introduced at this last WWDC, where they talked about them on the Mac side and said, hey, here's all the features. Oh, by the way, these are coming to the iPhone and iPad as well. And that's kind of like how I want to start approaching things a bit more. I will still absolutely have like my OS walkthrough videos, like my iPad OS, my iOS one. I wanna start doing a Mac OS one as well. But when it comes to videos like apps and shortcuts and those kinds of walkthroughs, I wanna start approaching it as the ecosystem and not necessarily device specific. So I'm curious to hear from you all where you get most of your work done these days. Are you somebody that's kind of like been following me because you got all in on the iPad, or are you kind of like 50-50 now more? Or are you like, I'm done with the iPad, let's go all in on the Mac? I'm curious to hear from you all. Or if it's something else, like, hey, I work from the iPhone or a PC or something. Just let me know in the comments below. My thanks to AnchorWork for sponsoring this video. If you liked it, hit the thumbs up button, subscribe if you haven't already, and have a great day.